Dr. Anandakeshan, shall we start the program? Will you start with a welcome address?
We start the program. Very good evening. Respected President of IAP Thrissur, Dr. Nadi Sadagma, Secretary Dr. Srijit, our today's three important national faculty, Dr. Dhiran Kanjwanga, Dr. Isaac Aroja, and Dr. Damani Ramnathan, and IAP President Dr. T.P. Jayaraman, and my dear friends. So, DDS Screening Committee, National DDS Screening Committee is doing a wonderful job under the leadership of all these mentioned our VIPs, Dr. Dhiran Kanjwanga, Isaac, and Damani. And for the last 6 months, I think on behalf of the IAP national level, they made a committee for screening also and doing a wonderful work. And so that we are to reduce the incidence of DDH. DDH is one of the important, I think it is unrecognized for some underestimated problem. Around 1 to 3% of children are suffering from DDH. Developmental dysplasia of hip. Previously it was called congenital dysplasia, but due to since it is continuum problem rather than a congenital problem, we replace the term with the developmental dysplasia of the hip joint. And the screening, early screening is very important because screening is very important in the sense that early treatment and the early treatment, early recognition, all are very important in this aspect. That is why we are arranging this meeting, because we don't know whether we are missing some cases of DDH or not. That is why we are arranging a wonderful meeting here. And 80, we are to detect immediately after birth. And I think our today's faculty will deal with the different types of investigation, clinical features, when to do a USG of hip, when to do an X-ray, and what will be the subject detail. So today we have our State President, Dr. Jayaraman. On behalf of the IAP Thrissur, I welcome you, sir, Dr. Jayaraman. I also welcome our President, Dr. Nadi Sadagma, always a very great academician and teacher. So welcome, Dr. Nadi Sadagma. I also welcome Head of the Department of Pediatrics, Dr. K.K. Purushottam sir. He is again another academician great teacher, Dr. K.K. Purushottam sir. And also I welcome all three speakers. So Dr. Henrik Aluji, and also Dr. Ramani Narasimhan, and also Dhiran Kanjwanga from Ahmedabad. I also welcome all the participants from different parts of the India. I think we can see so many people from outside Kerala also. We know that it is a very not very attractive subject in that way, but I think you can see, and today also there are 3-4 meetings are concurrently going on different parts of the state. That maybe I think we are expecting around 60 to 80 participants for the program. Again, I welcome all of you, and also I want to thank the DDH Screening Committee of India, especially Dr. Arik Aduji, Dhiran Kanjwanga, and Ramani Narasimhan, for taking keen interest in conducting such a program in Kerala, IAP Thrissur. Now I invite Dr. Nadi Sadagma for her presidential address.
Good evening, members. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. So, good evening, dear members. Welcome to a unique program hosted jointly by IAP Thrissur and the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India. The topic is Developmental Dysplasia of the Hip, Early Recognition and Treatment. The term DDH takes me back to my postnatal rounds and my own examination of a newborn. There were 3 to 4 must-dos, like looking for a cleft palate, feeling for the femoral pulse, trying to open the wee baby's eyelids. You know how difficult it is to look for a cataract, and not to forget examination of the hip for DDH. Today, I will be really happy to learn more about the correct way of looking for DDH and whether what I have been doing all these years, whether it is correct or not. We Thrissur IAP members are very happy today that our state president, Dr. Jayaram, and Dr. Mukesh hopefully will be there with us to grace the session. Dr. Jayaram had told us me in the morning that he'll be there for the inauguration, but I just got a call.
He's there.
Okay. Dr. Anandakeshwan, our South Zone Vice President, 2020 Associate Professor at Government Medical College, Thrissur, past Neurology, National Neurology Chapter President, promised me during the last meet, he will arrange national speakers for today's talk. So you have kept your words. A big thanks to you as I welcome you. Today for the talk, we have the doyens of orthopedics, who will be illuminating our minds on the do's and don'ts of examination for DDH. The keynote address by Dr. Alaric Arjus, Vice President of Orthopedic Society, Consultant Orthopedic Surgeon at Wadia Children's Hospital and Leelavati. The importance of early recognition by Dr. Dhiren Ganjwala, who is the President of Orthopedic Society of India. The incidence X-ray clinical examination by Dr. Remini Narasimham, who is the orthopedic surgeon at Apollo Indraprastha Hospital and who was a past president of the Pediatric Orthopedic Society. Actually, it's for the first time I'm knowing that there is a national screening committee for DDH. Members, this January has been packed with programs. 2 community programs, interacting with school students, our installation ceremony, celebrating Republic Day. I acknowledge today the spirited help of our secretary, Dr. Srijit, and all the team of the executive group for help rendered. Coming up this Sunday is a program in connection with World Leprosy Day. Do attend. And there is an exciting quiz for program. So not only do attend, read also and then register for the quiz, okay? So, corona or not, we do not still sit still. We will be conducting program. And to the national speakers today, sir, you all spoke, you all have come to Kerala, but here is an invitation from us from Thrissur IAP, a warm invite to you all. Once this corona is really damn, we'll put it down with our powerful COVID vaccines. After that, you must come and visit us. So thank you, and over to Dr. Jayaraman for the inaugural address.
Before that, welcome to Dr. Jayaraman Narasimham, and also we got a foreign guest, Dr. P.S.N. Menon, renowned endocrinologist from Dubai. Well, I welcome both of them. Now I invite Dr. Jayaraman sir for the formal inauguration of the program. Jayaraman sir.
Good evening, everybody. I am audible.
Yeah.
Respected President of Thrissur IAP, Dr. Reddy, Dr. Anandakeshwan, Dr. Mukesh, Dr. Purushottaman, and all the other distinguished faculties, Dr. P.S.N. Menon, the senior endocrinologist. I am very happy to grade this session by IAP on an important orthopedic issue in pediatrics, that is a developmental dysplasia of the hip joint in new babies. And this is very detection of these problems are very important in preventing the long-term disability and as well as the timely correction. And I expect we will have an enlightening CME with all national speakers, and I offer the very best for the program. And once again, thank you for inviting me to inaugurate this session. Thank you all.
So now I invite the Indian Orthopedic Pediatric Society Vice President Dr. Alaric Arjus and the main person behind the DDH screening committee to give you keynote. So what do we mean by this program? So I invite Dr. Alaric Arjus for this keynote address.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kesavan. Are my slides visible to everyone?
Yeah.
Thank you. So welcome to all the dignitaries from IIP Thrissur and from around the country for this first joint webinar that we're doing with IIP, FOSI, and the DDA screening committee. As Dr. Kesavan rightly said, we've been working on our baby for the last 9 months, and we will soon have some guidelines ready for IIP and for other national organizations that have been working seriously on this topic for since March of last year. To give you a little insight, I'm sure our speakers who are there on the panel today will give you a very elaborate description of what DDH actually is. And I know for many of you pediatricians, it's really not much on your radar because there's so many other things that you're dealing with. But I will show you from this talk and from the talks of the other dignitaries who are addressing this meeting that it is a fairly common condition which is often missed because of various reasons. So as we know, developmental dysplasia of the hip is actually a spectrum of an intracapsular displacement of the femoral head, which is occurring either before, but also can happen during or soon after birth. And the spectrum includes things right from a mild dysplasia to instability to subluxation or a frank dislocation. So what the DDH screening committee has done is under the leadership of IIP and the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India, we have got together an expert group of various professionals coming from organizations which deal with maternal and child health. And that includes the National Neonatology Forum, the various radiology associations of our country, the Obstetric and Gynec Associations, and our parent body, which is the Indian Orthopedic Association. And a lot of this work is being supported by our friends from Canada, from the University of British Columbia, and a charity called I'm a Hippie. So I'm proud to say that this screening committee that we have developed over the last many months represents approximately 1,25,000 healthcare professionals from India. That's a huge number. Of course, the big organizations are IIP and FOCSI, but also the Indian Orthopedic Association, the Radiology and the Ultrasound Association of India, and the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India, who actually initiated this topic under the guidance of our president, Dr. Dhiren Ganjwala. So we are going about it in a very scientific approach because we know that we don't have guidelines established for India since so many years. And it's a pressing problem that we all need to deal with. So rather than developing or adopting guidelines blindly that have been used in the West, we decided to form our own guidelines using four pillars of creating awareness, developing the evidence, establishing a consensus, and then implementing it. So the first step that we developed was to actually create awareness among our pediatrician colleagues and primary care physicians, because many of you all are not seeing enough of DDH. While we as orthopedic surgeons see a whole number of older children who come to us after the walking age. So obviously there's a gap between the diagnosis that's required at birth versus a late presentation that we see as orthopedic surgeons. So the key here was how to disseminate that awareness. So we began by building the evidence through a very detailed literature review, looking at the role of clinical examination, the role of ultrasound, accepting the fact that quality ultrasound and interpretation is not always available in many regions of our country. And can we supplement that with the use of X-rays as a tool for hip surveillance, which is quite routinely available to all of us wherever we are? The next step is development of consensus on some contentious issues and to see how we can adapt the international guidelines for our Indian scenario. And that's why we went through a Delphi process with multiple rounds. And I'm happy to say that we have completed this as of last week. And now we are beginning the exciting part of actually developing our guidelines. The next phase and last one would be the actual implementation with all the stakeholders. And that's where you members of IIP have a big role to play. Because all those guidelines, if they are only going to remain on paper, are going to be of no value unless actually implemented by all our pediatrician colleagues, because you are the ones who are actually going to check these children by clinical examination and then recommend when they should be forwarded to us as orthopedic surgeons for further management. And we hope that we can adapt a sort of a pathway that has been established elsewhere. This is a pathway which has been established by a working committee from the American Academy of Pediatrics and the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons. And we'll see how we can adapt that pathway so that it becomes valid and contextual for us in India. So with that, I would like to end this keynote address, and I thank you all so much for being part of this meeting and supporting this venture that we have jointly developed between IIP and POSI. Thank you very much. Dr. Kesavan, you're muted still.
Thank you, Alric Karin, sir, for that wonderful keynote address. And I think PSN Menon is there, sir. Sir? PSN Menon, sir. PSN Menon, sir. So, can you say a few words because you are unexpected guest, sir? So, you can see so many familiar faces also here. Dr. Kushagla, E.K. Parvi. Sir, you unmute, sir. Unmute.
Thank you, Dr. Ananda Keshavan. I think I just came to listen to the luminaries, and I don't want to take any of your time. I am a person who strongly believes in screening of newborns as well as in children in the very early period for developmental dysplasia, because this is a preventable disorder. Like any other preventable disorders, like congenital hypothyroidism, metabolic disorders. So I am interested in newborn screening and prevention of disability in children. And I am here to listen to you all. And I would like to be a silent participant and listener. I have some questions at the end of it about how we implement this program nationally. I think this is the need of the. I have nothing more to say. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, sir, for joining with us. I request Dr. Sijit to just say the word of thanks.
So, thank you, sir, Ananda Keshavan, sir, for inviting me to propose the word of thanks. And first of all, thank Ananda Keshavan, sir, for arranging such a CME to Thrissur to DDH. And I thank the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India to associate, thank for the willingness to associate with IEP Thrissur to have this program. So I personally thank the President of Pediatric Orthopedic Society, Dr. Dheeran Genchwala, sir, from Ahmedabad, and also thank Dr. Ramani Narasimhan, sir, from the past, from the Delhi. And we are the Alaric Aridus from the Vice President of POSI. So I thank all the dignitaries who have joined here. I also thank the TP Jayaraman, sir, for inaugurating the session, and also thank the Office Bureau of IEP Thrissur, Dr. Redhi Shantangumar and Mugir, sir, will join us in any time soon. Over to you, sir. Thank you, and Darshan, sir. Sir, you are muted, sir. Ananda Keshavan, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sijit Kumar, for the thank you. And also, I would like to, without wasting any time, we'll directly go to the scientific program. First, I meet Dr. Dheeran Genchwala, and sir is the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India president, and he is a pediatric orthopedician at the Vala Hospital, Jivaraj Mehta Hospital, and Research Center for the month. And so early diagnosis, all the mentioned Alvig and the other speakers, early diagnosis is very, very crucial for the diagnosis of DDH. So I invited Dr. Dheeran Genchwala, sir, for giving his delivery to his talk. Over to Dr. Dheeran Genchwala.
Right. Thank you very much. Now, the first question is like, why this webinar or why this whole screening program? So I would like to give a title to my talk, that few minutes of yours can save a lifelong misery of many children. So why I am saying that? Let's come to that. So first of all, I would like to say that why this session is important. And I really appreciate the enthusiastic pediatrician who has come to listen to this point, because we consider all the time that pediatricians are not really interested in this talk. But today, I would like to say that my understanding or impression was wrong. And pediatricians are really enthusiastic to learn about this and to implement the knowledge in the practice. This is a scenario of 1998, a center which we call it Apang Manav Mandal, a very popular center in Ahmedabad, which serves the children with physical impairment. This center was very popular and they have a hostel, and where these children affected by polio, they come, stay, and they learn because these children are not accepted elsewhere. I'm happy to say that in last 10 years, there is not a single child with a polio has been admitted or has enrolled in this school. And why this has happened is because of the polio vaccination campaign, which all pediatricians across India have popularized, along with the Rotary International and with the government helps. And now we are on the verge of eradication of polio. That's a great achievement of humanity. That's a great achievement of medicine. Now, let's come to the topic, and I would like to explain the importance of the hip in our life. Recently, we saw a lot of pictures on the 26th January, a lot of children, they are running, jumping with the Indian flag. And we all were very happy to see that. For that activity, we need hip. In addition to that, for the routine activity like sitting cross-legged or squatting, which is important for Indian society, we need a good functioning hips. For karate or for yoga or like this gymnastic, we need a full functioning hips. So full functioning hips are very important. And those of us who have a full functioning hip, we really don't understand and we don't pay any gratitude to the nature and to the Almighty. However, all are not really fortunate. There are few people, and I'm going to tell you something about those unfortunate people and how their life is affected because of this problem. So I'm going to describe three cases, and each case is going to give one important message. So let's start with the case one. This was a case of a five-year-old girl. She presented to us with a limp. I'm sure that you will be able to find out something abnormal in this X-ray. I will not ask, but it's very evident. And you can see that the right side of the hip joint is dislocated. If you look at the left hip, the femoral head is in the socket, while on the left, on the right, the femoral head is not in front of the socket, that's acetabulum, and it's lying out. To show you this, for the sake of easy understanding, I am now going to describe the whole treatment on this animation. So as shown in this, the right femoral head is outside the cup. It's very easy on the animation to bring it down, and we can definitely bring it down. But when we bring down, the muscles which I have shown, that muscle, we call it adductor muscles. But let's remember that there are a lot of muscles surrounding the hip joint. And when we try to bring the femoral head down at the level of acetabulum, all the surrounding muscles, they become tight. And these tight muscles, they spring back the femoral head out of the cup. So to avoid that, what we do is that we can't cut all the muscles surrounding the hip joint because they are important for the function. So instead of that, what we do, we take out a segment of the femoral bone and then we shorten the femur bone so that now the muscles are relaxed and the hip is now stable inside the cup. Now let's focus our attention. Before that, we have cut the bone, so we fix it with a plate and screw. Now let's focus our attention to the two arrows. The one on the left and try to see on the right. Can you see the difference? Yes, the right acetabulum is shallow while on the left, it's well covering the femoral head. So to improve that part at the age of 5, what we do, we cut the portion of the bone, that's ilium, about the femoral head, about the acetabulum, and then we try to bring it down and we create a gap and then we put a femoral bone which we have taken from the shaft. So now this procedure which I showed you in the form of animation will be done in around 2-2.5 hours, and after that the child is given a plaster covering the full length on one side and half of the length on the other side. So this is the post-operative x-ray. The femoral head is well covered and you can see the plate and screw. So it looks very good. However, let me tell you something about this surgery. The surgery for the DDH, developmental dysplasia of the hip, particularly for the cases which present late, is technically demanding. There are very few people in the India, I would say that number is around 200 to 300, who can do this technically demanding surgery confidently and well every time they come across this situation. This surgery takes around 2.5 to 3 hours. After this long surgery, the child is kept in a bed, in a plaster for 3 months. And after removing the plaster for 3 months, they need a rehabilitation in the form of exercise for another 3 to 6 months so that they can start walking normally, so that they can start attending the school. The cost varies from center to center. In my private setup, the cost would be around 1.5 lakhs rupees. The most important question you will be asking to us is like, do they become normal after surgery? I'm sure that my colleagues would agree that most of them, yes, they become all right, but not all. Before we proceed, let me tell you the point which hurts me the most. And I'm here to discuss this point with you. This girl presented to us at the age of 5 or 2 months. In this 62 months, she has visited pediatrician 19 times. And it's really unfortunate that in the 18 times, this condition was not detected. I don't want to blame anyone, but this is really a situation which requires improvement. And for that, all of us has to work together. There are a lot of reasons. If I ask you why was it missed, there are a series of reasons for that. And we are not going to discuss that at this point because that's not important. That's not the focus of my lecture. Now, let's come to the second case, which is going to give us a different message. This was a child presented with the both hips dislocated. So at the age of 2, the child underwent surgery on both sides. At 4, the one hip was going out again in spite of the surgery. So child underwent second surgery. They presented to us at the age of 8 years. And I'm sure that you don't really need too much of orthopedic knowledge. A simple examination of this x-ray will tell us that the left hip is good, but right hip is not normal. If you look at the left acetabulum is well covering the femoral head, while the one on the right, the yellow one, is a shallow acetabulum. The surgery was suggested to this child, the third surgery at the age of 8 years. The family said that no, child is not having pain and we really don't want to do anything. At 16, the child presented with a pain, which was at rest also, and pain increases on routine activity like standing, walking, running. This is the X-ray which shows that the right hip has subluxated again. So there is a pain and there is a radiological features suggestive of what we call it arthritis or wear and tear. And this right hip is painful. So this case gives a message that surgery cannot make all the hip normal. Particularly those cases presenting late, surgery can improve in most of the cases, but some unfortunate hip, in spite of surgery, they don't become normal. Coming to the case three, this is about a 3-week-old child. The pediatrician observed that on examination, the child's hip is reduced. He referred to me. I asked for sonography. Sonography confirmed the diagnosis of DDH of the hip. The treatment in the form of a Pawlik harness was suggested. This is a belt which keeps the hip into flexion and in abduction. The treatment was continued for 3 months. At 8 years, if you look at X-rays, shows that hips are normal. And these are the clinical features which shows that both hips are normal. The child is able to squat, able to sit cross-legged. These are the important activities for Indian society. And this child can do it. So now my question is, who played an important role? A sharp observation by a smart pediatrician really made a big difference in this child's life. Now the question is, which group of patients have the best outcome? There is no question about it. It's basically the early treated cases. The treatment is less expensive. There is a less suffering for child, for the family. There are less chances of complications. And there is a significantly better outcome. So I would just like to repeat the message I conveyed by three cases. The first case said that late presenting cases need a major reconstructive surgery, the 3-hour surgery, 3 hours of surgery with a lot of expense, 3 months of plaster, 3 to 6 months of exercise, and yes, most of them, they become all right. However, the outcome is not good in every case. We saw that in the second case, and that second case will require the total hip replacement now at the age of 16, and he will need that repeated total hip replacement at every 10 to 15 years. The third case gave us an example that, or a message that early treatment gives a long-lasting hip, which will last 60 to 70 years of the lifespan. So early treatment should be our aim. For early treatment, we must detect it early. So any child presented with DDH at the age of 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks can go on two paths. The first path is early treatment by early diagnosis. And some unfortunate, they go for a late diagnosis and late treatment. And it all depends on the pediatrician, whether the child will go on the early treatment path or will go on the late treatment path. I am sure that if we work together, then definitely we can send almost all children towards the path of early treatment. And I would just like to end my talk saying that definitely we can prevent the lifelong misery of many kids, many children. And if we work together, then definitely every child, even those who are born with the DDH, can have a normal running, standing, walking, jumping, all the games is possible. But for that, early diagnosis and early treatment is must. So with that, I would like to stop my presentation. Thank you once again for the opportunity.
So thank you, sir, for that wonderful session, especially for stressing the early diagnosis and the treatment. If we are late, then it may lead to some permanent problems of sort. I think we'll take the questions at the end of the session. So now we'll have the second talk on DDH incidence, clinical examination and imaging. I think another important session by Dr. Devani Narasimhan, sir. He is a senior consultant, a pediatric orthopedic surgeon, and also Indraprastha Apollo Hospital, New Delhi. And also he was the past president of the Pediatric Orthopedic Association of India. So over to Dr. Devani Narasimhan, sir. Thank you for joining with us. So over to you.
Good evening, Dr. Kesavan, and good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to be a part of this meeting. And after that wonderful talk by Dr. Dhiren, I hope to hammer home and build upon the whole thing and hammer home the message that he has conveyed. So, we just discussed about the importance of early diagnosis, but I am going to build up the whole talk. And here we know that DDH is a spectrum of disorders. It was called congenital dislocation of the hip, but it's actually a spectrum of disorders which that present in different forms at different ages. It's a disorder which evolves over time, and etiology can be multifactorial. It's not moving. Just a second. All right. In DDH, the excessive laxity of the hip capsule failing to maintain the head within the acetabulum is the main problem. And in the clinical examination, it's important that the gold standards that we are talking about is Ottolani's test and Barlow's provocative test. So building upon that, in a Barlow's provocative test, we are testing a dislocatable hip. The hip actually in a neonate is actually inside, but when we hold the thighs and bring them closer to each other and push from anterior to posterior, the hips which are unstable, they are bound to come out. And that is a Barlow's provocative test. Similarly, if a hip is already dislocated, then pulling the hip from adducted position, that is when the thighs are close to each other, and gently pushing the trochanters, the bony prominences in the anterior direction, and then abducting, taking the hips away from each other, would actually relocate the hips inside. So these two maneuvers are an important screening tests for all the primary care providers for the neonates, for them to know and pick up the problem very earlier on through clinical examination. Then there is an important clinical sign, which is a decrease in abduction. When you actually are trying to take the thighs out in a slightly older child, not necessarily a neonate, maybe after 2 months, then the side which is affected, that would not abduct that much, because if the hip is already dislocated, that would be a mechanical stoppage for the thigh to go outside. So when a pediatrician, for example, you people, when you examine a child and when you see a decrease in abduction, that is a very important and a very reliable sign. I will come to that, how reliable it is through studies, but that is a very reliable sign for you to suspect DDH and probably refer the child to the orthopedic surgeon. Then there is a positive Galeazzi sign. When you flex the hip, flex the knees and bring them close to each other, when the child is lying supine on the table, then the unequal heights of the knees can also make you suspect DDH. Then there is this there are so many other signs, asymmetrical clinical folds. Now this as a solo examination, as a single examination, is not a predictable sign for DDH. But if that is accompanied with, say, this Galeazzi's sign, which I just spoke about, or a limited abduction, then it actually carries value. But the most reliable sign, we will come to that again in the slides which will follow, that the most reliable sign is a limitation of abduction. Then just a word about ultrasound. Now, it is second to the clinical examination. Its use is there if the risk factors are positive, like a family history of DDH, a breech presentation, oligohydramnios. Graf is a pioneer, so the Graf, the standards are taken. We will just come to that. And it's a valuable adjunct to detect DDH. And there is a controversial role of its screening. Then we measure alpha and beta angles. Alpha angles are more reliable because when you actually measure it, it is against the bony part of the acetabulum, whereas the beta angles are measuring against the soft tissue. And it's most importantly, it's an observer dependent. So the consistency of its reporting is sometimes a problem. And in other words, if there are 100 people reporting a certain problem, there could be a lot of variability in their reporting. Like I said, ultrasound is observer dependent. Now this side is showing a non-concentric reduction, whereas this side is showing a concentric reduction. This is the graph classification. I'm not going to go into details, but the alpha angles more than 60 is probably a good reduction. It's a good reduction. Then there is a type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4. Type 4 being a totally dislocated hip, which should not be missed. That is the basic idea. Then there is type 3, where there is a lateralization. The hip is not totally properly covered, but there is a little bit, the hip is slightly, you know, more lateral than where it is supposed to be. Then there is, of course, type 1 is normal. Then there is a lot of talk about type 2, which is again divided into type 2 A, B, and C, and D. What is important to understand is lots of ultrasounds which are done in the early part of infancy, they can show abnormality, but majority of them are apparently they become normal, but only a part of it, maybe 20 to 30% go on to actually become and show a very significant DDH at a later age. We will again come to that in the papers that follow. X-rays are gold standard by and large, and it's generally done around 3.5 to 4 months. And you try to avoid X-rays before that because the neonate or an early infant is very susceptible to the radiation that comes out of it. There are lots of things that you see on an X-ray. And another important idea of doing an X-ray at a later age is you don't want to get the X-rays done when most of the bones are cartilaginous. So it's very difficult to interpret the X-rays. But if the X-rays are done at a certain age where the bones are more visible, then you can interpret their X-rays better. And one of the most important things that you see is a Shenton's line, where the inferior part of the neck and the inferior part of the superior ramus is in continuity, and you know that this hip is in. And if the hip is dislocated, then like Dr. Dhiren showed, the head is all lying somewhere in this, just at around the superolateral quadrant and above. So that's how it is. And there are so many other parameters. One of the important indices that we measure to check on the development of the cup or the acetabulum is the acetabular index. And there are so many other lines that we draw, which I'm not going to go into details. And again, there is a superior gap. There is a medial gap, like the medial gap we just talked about, and a superior gap. And that is all as you go and dissect out the X-ray and try to understand whether the child has DDH or if the treatment of the DDH has been effective by getting those X-rays done and seeing whether the X-ray picture is correlating with the clinical picture. Now, the incidence of DDH, I'm going to go through certain studies and make you aware of the fact that how common DDH is. And sometimes, and the brain, the eyes will see what the brain knows. So unless and until I convey to you what all the various studies and the importance, then you would probably, at the end of this talk, you will realize how important the DDH and incidence of DDH, how great it is. So this is by Weinstein, one of the stalwarts of pediatric orthopedics. He acknowledged the fact that the DDH terminology is most confusing. And when we talked about DDH, it could mean instability, dysplasia, subluxation, or dislocation. Now, developmental dislocations actually mean complete irreducible dislocations, and DDH incidence varies from 25 to 30 per thousand in Laps or Native Americans to a very low incidence in Chinese or African descent. See the variability. The true incidence of dislocation probably is 1 to 1.5 per thousand. Now, in one of the Herring Tazdian's pediatric orthopedics books, DDH is a spectrum of disorders, as was mentioned by Dr. Alaric. And incidence is difficult to determine because definition is there is a query in definition, query in the examination type, query in the examination skill, and also variability in a population. Some degree of hip instability in the newborns, 1 in 1,000 to 3.4 in 100, 3.4% is actually seen. And consistent data on the incidence of two dislocations, again, is 1 to 1.5 per thousand. Now, there was a study by Dr. A.K. Gupta in our country, where a large number of newborns were examined. Both the orthopedic surgeon and pediatrician was involved. Clinical examination, X-ray and ultrasound were done. 18.7 per thousand live births, instability was seen in the first examination. 12.1 per thousand live births had a subluxatable hips, which is partial dislocations. 0.82 per thousand had dislocatable hips. Neonatal hip instability is common in New Delhi. That was what they concluded. And a screening program should be initiated to detect its incidence in other parts of India. Now, Bialik et al. In developmental dysplasia in new approach to incidence. This was published in Pediatrics volume in 1999. They acknowledged the controversy over the incidence. They acknowledged that the controversy over the incidence stems mainly from an ambiguity of criteria for defining a genuinely pathological neonatal hip. And three eras of modern medicine where incidence was acknowledged, and where there was period one, where DDH was arbitrarily estimated. There was a period two, which was where the DDH was estimated by physical examination and late presenting cases. That was from 1950s to 1980s. But nowadays, with the advent of ultrasound and emergence of ultrasound, this is period three from 1980s to present. So the importance of ultrasound was given, but it was also acknowledged that lots of ultrasounds which were actually abnormal in the initial part of the infancy those hips, not all of them necessarily went ahead to become DDH, actual DDH. So there was something known as an apparent DDH at the early part of infancy, and there was a true DDH at the end of 1 year. So that was acknowledged. So only 90 hips remained abnormal and required treatment, indicating a true DDH incidence of 5 per thousand. And so this two categories were important. It was important to distinguish between these two categories. Then Danielson, he talked about instability of hip in neonates in JPJS 2000, prospective study between 1990 and 1997, an ethnic and geographic study in Sweden, and neonatal dislocatable and unstable at examination in the first 5 days of delivery. And incidence of treated hips ranged from 5.8% to 7.6%. And no significant difference was seen in the incidence between the newborn infants of Swedish and foreign parents. Genetic, racial, and geographic factors had a minor importance. Then there was Pellet E. et al., who talked about the neonatal incidence of hip dysplasia. And this was also published in 2008. 45,497 neonates were studied, born between 1992 and 2001. In 1993, the total neonatal incidence of DDH, including graft type 2, was 5.26%, changing gradually until it reached 3.41% in 1999 and then increased again into 4.51% in 2001. Sonographic type 2A had major effects on the incidence of overall developmental dysplasia. More severe sonographic abnormalities showed relatively stable incidence patterns. Then there was Balwani and Madhuri, Dr. Risha Madhuri from Vellore, who did a research on South Indian infants to determine the incidence of DDH and ultrasonological hip abnormality in their population. 1,000 consecutive infants at 6 weeks were studied. The incidence of sonographically abnormal hips was 7.5%. The incidence of graft type 2 were 74 in 1,000 infants. The hip dislocation rate was 1 in 1,000. And Loader HT and Skopolja EN, in a review article, they talked about systematic review for articles on DDH, difficulties in searching the literature because of the many variant names for DDH. They acknowledged that the standard databases extensively used, it resulted in 2,277 unique manuscripts, out of which 422 were used. The incidence of conventional DDH per 1,000 in India was 0.42 in various regions. They actually brought out the incidence was actually varying in different parts of India or two, which was 0.42 in Ballabgarh in Haryana, 1 to 2.65 in New Delhi, and 9.2 in Northern India. The incidence of neonatal hip instability per 1,000 is 0.75 in Mumbai and 18.7 in New Delhi. There is significant variability in incidence within each racial group by geographical location. And in IJO, that is Indian Journal of Orthopedics, Dr. Benjamin Joseph also acknowledged the need for screening for DDH. Then there is a study from Mongolia, a prospective cohort study, determined the incidence of ultrasonographic DDH in newborns. 8,356 newborns were screened in 1 year, and the percentage of the various types of graft types were established and they were brought about. And children with type 2 hips again were seen and received follow-up with ultrasounds at monthly intervals. Role of swaddling on the unsteady development of type 2A hips was acknowledged. Early ultrasound-based assessment and splinting treatment of DDH led to mature hips in all children who were followed up. Kob et al. Talked about low incidence of early DDH in universal ultrasonographic screening of newborns. They analyzed and evaluated the risk factors. The purpose of this study was evaluation of incidence and risk factors of a very early DDH in a modern cohort based on a universal ultrasound screening program. Again, a large number of consecutive hips of newborns were screened. Sonographic hip signs of DDH of the hips were found in 0.24% of the newborns. A significant negative influence of the risk factors, birth weight, family history of DDH and female gender on the alpha angle was formed. In conclusion, universal ultrasound screening for DDH at the age of 6 to 8 weeks was favored. Woodcare et al. Talked about the epidemiological DDH within UK, defining the risk factors. Investigate the local epidemiology of DDH in order to define incidence, identify risk factors, and refine their policy on selective ultrasound screening. It was a prospective study. 182 children born with DDH were studied. Incidence was 4.9 per 1,000 live births. And a small proportion of cases with normal neonatal examinations and no risk factors was acknowledged that they will still go undetected. And this is an arthrogram just to complete the various imagings that we use. And this arthrogram is generally when the child is under GA and when we are actually managing DDH and treating DDH and getting the hip back into the socket. So we use this and to check on mainly the closed reductions under general anesthesia. And, you know, the basic thing is if we talk about the medial dipole here, put in a radio-opaque dye, the medial dipole, if it is less than 5 millimeters, we are happy. If it is 5 to 6, then it is iffy. Then if it is more than 6, then we know it's unstable and sometimes requires an open reduction. Then we talk about safe zones. Again, this is a kind of a clinical examination that we do when we are doing a closed reduction or an open reduction in order to understand how stable the hip is inside and whether it requires any more, anything else to be done to make the hip more stable. Then we talk about central edge angles in an older child where anything more than 20 degrees is better and less than that is requires intervention. Now, is limitation of hip abduction is a useful clinical sign in the diagnosis of DDH? Well, Chaudhary and Payton, they actually concluded in this paper in 2013 that limited hip abduction should be actively sought after 8 weeks of age and it's a reliable sign. Then there is, again, there is another paper in 2002 in Journal of Bone and Joint Diseases where it was a unilateral limitation of abduction of the hip was highly specific and reasonably sensitive sign. It was more sensitive than a neonatal Ottolani's maneuver, which has been considered to be the method of choice. And its presence in infant over the age of 3 or 4 months makes further investigations essential. So just emphasizing on the importance of limited hip abduction. Then a positive, there was a paper on positive predictive value of asymmetrical skin creases and diagnosis of pathological developmental DDH by Anderson and Payton, and where they concluded that isolated asymmetric skin creases are an unreliable clinical sign in the diagnosis of pathological DDH. Again, a hip a minute examination, especially for you pediatricians, has been, you know, it's an important thing that you may want to practice. A normal hip abduction more than 60 degrees on both sides. If abduction is restricted on one or both sides, then rule out DDH. Bend and flex both knees with the hips resting on the bed and see the level of the knees. If one side appears lower, rule out DDH. And these things basically take less than a minute, but saves a lifetime of disability. And you can actually refer to the orthopedic surgeon who can then confirm whatever is suspected. In a neonate, Pavlik harness is preferred. Use in all Ottolani positive hips. Use in all Barlow positive hips. Use in all graft 3 and 4 hips. In clinically normal hips, abnormal on ultrasound at 6 weeks. And there is a study from Italy who worked on 4,648 neonates. They also acknowledged that 88% of these with abnormal ultrasound early in an infancy, they become normal at 6 to 8 weeks. So even though ultrasound is an important tool, it has to be used judiciously. The main aim of treatment with Pavlik harness is to achieve concentric reduction and prevent avascular necrosis. And now the question arises that now, when we have this Pavlik harness, which is not even an intervention, it's just a kind of a brace, then why would anyone hesitate to put this on, even in suspected cases earlier, than to wait and struggle later with presumed small number of progressive cases of DDH? So, personally, I would hesitate to give this Pavlik harness even at an early stage of so-called abnormal ultrasound. And I would rather have a normal hip at the end of 2 months, 3 months, than to not to give an ultrasound and get some abnormal 20% of abnormal DDH, which would be more difficult to treat at a later age. We certainly want to avoid treating at this age. We don't, like Dr. Dhiren showed, bilateral DDH. You're doing all kinds of things, doing open reduction, adductor tenotomy, doing a femoral procedure, doing a pelvic procedure. And the predictability of these hips actually getting normal is again iffy thing, and it requires a long-term follow-up. So what we are still struggling with, a standardized definition of DDH. incidence of DDH is strongly influenced by the screening method. Ultrasound is still iffy. When to do it, how to do it, the skill set involved because of the observer dependency and overdiagnosis. Neonatal hip instability has come out in a big way, and people have recognized to actually acknowledge it and then follow such hips to see whether these hips actually get into becoming a true DDH. True incidence of DDH is not equal to a neonatal incidence like we just discussed. All studies recognize swaddling having a significant influence, so safe swaddling methods should be practiced. Absence of adequate, well-conducted, standardized studies in India. So we are working towards doing more studies and understanding DDH in our country. Incidence of DDH does seem to have surely surpassed that of CTV. So this is the message which I want to convey. We have to take DDH more seriously, pick them up early, and you, especially as primary care pediatricians, primary care physicians for children, need to pick it up early and refer them early for them to get the best treatment. Thank you very much.
So, thank you, sir, for that excellent talk on incidence and clinical features and the different clinical methods how to demonstrate this one. That is also important for pediatricians, sir. I think, and also for the excellent review of the literature, there are so many, you reviewed so many articles also. I think we'll postpone the questions at the end of our session. Now we have the last talk in the series. We have talk by Dr. Alaric Arunji's risk factors for DDHs and development of screening guidelines. I think it's something mentioned by Dr. Narasimhan also, but I think we'll hear more from Dr. Alaric Arunji. He is the consultant orthopedic surgeon in Iravadi and the Hindija Hospital, and also vice president of Pediatric Orthopedic Association. So, over to Eric Adu.
Thank you, Dr. Keswan, again. And since I already covered my initial part of the updates on where the screening program lies, I will be covering that now. So, I will only cover something which is really very important. And the message that I would like to give to all our pediatrician colleagues who are on this call today. Is my screen visible to everyone?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great, thank you. So while the guidelines that we develop will hopefully over the next 10 or 20 years, with the help of all of you, bring down the incidence of late diagnosed DDH, I'm going to talk about something today which will reduce the incidence of DDH by almost 2/3 right away. And that is something that very few of us are aware of as pediatricians. And I wish to bring this to your attention so that while we work on our guidelines and implementation of them over the next many years, there's something we can do that's in our hands that can reduce the incidence of late presenting DDH. So when you look at the various risk factors for DDH, we used to have a number of factors that we studied as students, but over the many years, it has been shown very clearly that there are just 3 or 4 important risk factors that have been proven to be associated with DDH. The first that most of you pediatricians are well aware of is a breech presentation. And it's not important when the baby turned breech, whether it was in the last trimester or at the time of delivery, but anytime you have a breech presentation that is known, especially with a frank breech, that is the single most important risk factor for DDH, having an incidence of almost 2 to 27%. So almost a quarter of children who have a breech presentation or breech delivery will have an associated hip dysplasia. And as I've shown you, the frank breech in a girl child is really the highest risk for a hip dislocation. Those are the children who must be screened very regularly so that we don't miss DDH. The second most important risk factor is a positive family history, especially in a first degree relative like a sister or the mother. We know that that's a 12 times higher risk for DDH. So therefore, whenever you have a pregnant mother who comes to you, you must ask them whether they have had a history of a hip displacement or a limp or a shortening. Most of them will not know what hip dislocation is. But if you ask them, did you have a limp in the family or did you have a person who had a short leg, then that's a red flag to tell you that this child probably is at risk of hip dislocation. And the third important risk factor, which where we bind the child in extension and adduction, and this is the third most important risk factor for DDH. So what really is swaddling? I'm sure all of you are aware of this. It is either called binding or bundling, or some nurses even call it mummification. And it's supposed to mimic the snugness of the womb and limit the motor reflex. And we all know that swaddling is something that we see very routinely in our clinics. I know I've passed by well baby clinics and even in NICU, and I see so many children who have been bundled up like this. And it was the accepted norm and practice even during my entire training, and I never felt anything was wrong in this. We all know that swaddling has several benefits, and it's been a very much of an Eastern culture since time immemorial. In fact, if you remember from the Bible, it's been well described 2000 years ago that when Jesus Christ was born, he was actually wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in the manger because there was no room for him at the inn. So it's been shown that for almost 2,000 to 3,000 years, swaddling has been a practice in most Eastern populations. And over the last few decades, it started to get popular even in Western countries because of several benefits that the pediatric organizations abroad have shown, which includes better sleep and temperature control, a reduced risk of sudden infant death syndrome if you put the children to sleep on their backs. There's a faster recovery from painful stimuli as compared to using a pacifier. And in children with neonatal cerebral insults, we know that decreased crying because of the comfort provided by swaddling. But there are several hazards of incorrect swaddling as well, including overheating if the child is bundled up too tightly and especially the head is covered. There's increased risk sometimes of respiratory infections and vitamin D deficiency. There's risk of suffocation and death if the child is swaddled and placed prone. But I think what is not recognized is this very high risk of hip dysplasia if swaddling is performed incorrectly. So in this little animation, I'll show you what exactly happens in when you swaddle a child. So we know that the child's hip is soft and cartilaginous, and the ligaments of the hip are quite flexible when the child is born because the relaxant hormones are circulating in the mother's body to allow the child to be born very easily. And if we pull the limbs into adduction and extension, then that very relaxed capsule of the hip joint can give way and allow the hip to undergo a dislocation soon after birth. So remember that this is not a prenatal or antenatal hip dislocation. It's actually happening postnatally because of something that we are doing to position the hips in the wrong manner, which causes the hip to dislocate out. So it has been shown in several studies now across the world that in cultures where children are carried with their hips abducted, the hip, usually DDH, is not so common. Whereas in countries where hips are bundled together with their legs close together on a cradle board, it was very common at one time in Mexico and among the Native Americans, the incidence of DDH was as high as 20%. And countries where they have been taught, my mother has been taught how to correctly swaddle the infant, the incidence of hip dislocation has dramatically decreased. Now, there are several studies which have shown that traditional swaddling, the way we do it in so many parts of India, is a proven risk factor for DDH. In fact, among the Navajo, when diapers were introduced, there was a dramatic decrease in the incidence of DDH. In Japan, when they started a anti-swaddling program in the 1970s, the incidence of DDH decreased by two-thirds, from 1 to 3.5% to less than 0.2%. So within a span of 10 years, there was such a dramatic decrease in the incidence of DDH by a simple program of avoiding traditional swaddling and using instead a hip-safe swaddling. Experimentally, it's also been shown in rats that if you swaddle the infant rats early and for a prolonged time in a hip in extension, the risk of DDH is extremely high. So here's a mother in our maternal hospital in Mumbai. And we asked her to show us how she swaddles her child. And I'm sure all of you will identify with this because this is done by almost every mother in every clinic that we see. It's done by the nurses in our well baby clinics and in our NICUs. And you can see specifically what the mother is doing here. She's pulling the legs down to straighten them. And if you ask her why she did this, she said the child's legs are bent, which we don't like. And we have been told that if this legs are left like this, the child will have bow legs when they start walking. And that's a common misconception. We know that all neonates are born with hip and knee flexion deformities, which is exactly normal and physiological. And trying to straighten the legs out, like what this young mother is doing, is that it is very detrimental for the hip development. So what is the solution? That swaddling, of course, is good. It has its benefits, but it should be done in a hip-safe manner. So what is hip-safe swaddling? It means that we allow the hips to remain in slight flexion and abduction and external rotation, keep the knees slightly flexed, allow the hips to move freely within the swaddle, and you'll realize that babies actually naturally want to sleep in this froggy leg position because that's how they have been in the womb. So we decided to do a little survey in our own institution, which is one of the largest pediatric hospitals in India, the Wadia Children's Hospital, which is a twin maternity and childcare hospital. And we decided to survey our pediatricians, nurses, and caregivers to see what their attitudes towards swaddling are. And we published this in the Journal of Indian Journal of Orthopedics. And any of you who's interested can Google that out, and I can send you the link if you'd like, because the results were quite revealing to us. So we looked at all our pediatricians, 45 pediatricians from our twin institutions. We had 12 full-time faculty and 33 trainees. More than half of them routinely advised mothers about swaddling, and almost all of them taught traditional swaddling. When we asked our pediatricians about the awareness of risk factors, most of them correctly identified that breech is a significant risk factor, but less than one third of them were aware that traditional swaddling is a risk factor for DDH. When we looked at our nurses, we looked at 219 nurses, and these were all pediatric and maternity nurses. They were not general nurses. They were from different cadres, right, from junior nurses to very senior teaching staff who instruct and train nurses in the wards. And all of them routinely advise mothers on swaddling, and 99% of them advise traditional swaddling. When we asked them where they learned about swaddling, this was a big revelation for us, because two-thirds of them said they actually learned how to swaddle children during the nursing training, and only one-third said they learned it from their family members. So this is such an important information that came to us. We randomly picked up 100 caregivers who were bringing their babies to the well-baby clinics of our hospital for vaccination visits, and 90% of them routinely swaddled their infants, and all of them used traditional swaddling. When we asked them where they learned swaddling from, as expected, most of them said they learned it from their family members, especially the women in the family, the mothers, mothers-in-law, or their sisters and others. But a significant population, at least two-thirds of them, said that the nurses actually taught us this when we brought our child for the well-baby clinic vaccination visit, when they took the anthropometry and did the weights. They then taught us how to swaddle children in this particular manner. When we asked them why were you swaddling your child, most of them said that the child sleeps better, it provides nice warmth to the baby, it makes us easy to carry the child. But very worryingly, more than half of the nurses and more than 60% of the caregivers said that we didn't like the child's knees to be bent, and we were told that if the child has these kind of bent legs, they will start walking with a bow leg position, and it's very important to straighten the legs out. So the Malishwali Bai and the massager who came to our house used to always massage the legs straight, pull the legs into extension, and taught us how to swaddle the child in this manner. When we asked them, were you aware of hip-safe swaddling? Only 7% of our pediatricians, 4% of the caregivers, and none of the nurses were aware of this concept of hip-safe swaddling. So despite, globally, there are so many position statements made by the International Hip Dysplasia Institute, by the American Academy of Pediatrics, by various orthopedic associations to talk about the importance of hip-safe swaddling, but this information has still not percolated down to the healthcare providers, pediatricians, primary care physicians, nurses, and even the lay population in our country. So if you'd like to visit the website of the International Hip Dysplasia, there are different swaddling techniques that any of you can pick up and learn very easily. And I'll show you some of them. So here is one of them where you swaddle called what's the diamond technique, which is very traditional and typical that what we all do, take it in a triangular manner, the swaddling cloth. Then you place the child in it. You can see that we bind the upper limbs the way we do it traditionally, tucking it below the child's chest so that the swaddle stays in place. And then you can see that what we're doing here is this child's lower limbs are in that position of flexion, abduction, and external rotation that the baby actually wants to remain in. And rather than trying to pull the legs down, we gently use the swaddle cloth to keep those hips in that same position. So this is using the diamond technique. You can use the same thing using a square piece of cloth. Again, you can see the baby being laid down. The upper limbs are swaddled in the same traditional manner, keeping the arms by the side. And here you can see again, the lower limbs are kept in that position of what the baby actually wants it to be, flexion, abduction, external rotation. We gently fold the cloth upwards so that it's nice and broad at the base. And then we tuck it below the baby so that the swaddle stays in place. And you can see that this is a nice broad base swaddle, which will keep the hips protected from a hip displacement. So therefore we realize as we develop these guidelines for hip dislocation in India, there are several strategies and a multi-pronged approach that we need to take to create simple awareness about this very important technique that very few of us are aware about. Once we came to know about the results from this survey, we immediately instituted an institutional policy at our organization. We developed a white paper and circulated to all the nurses and the pediatricians about the importance of hip safe swaddling. Not only that, we carried out monthly training for nurses, pediatric residents, and fellows who are the younger people who would learn this technique in the right way. We also started training mothers in the well-baby clinics about the importance of hip-safe swaddling by developing posters to be displayed in clinics and wards. And I'm happy to say that thanks to the liaison that we now develop with IAP, as part of our guidelines, we will also develop position statements and some flyers or brochures that can be circulated to all members of IAP about the importance of hip-safe swaddling. We also plan to include in the curriculum for medical and nursing trainees and on the government sector to include this in the training manuals of ASHA workers, midwives, and other allied healthcare professionals who are involved with maternal and child healthcare in every village of India. So in conclusion, I would like to say that here's a technique that I'm providing to you, which you can adopt right away in your clinic. We know that traditional swaddling has always been very prevalent in India. It's deeply rooted in our culture. But there are certain misconceptions that we have about how a child should be swaddled. And a lot of it is because of what has come down to us from our elders. And it will take us some time and some effort as healthcare providers to first learn this technique and then to become advocates, to train others, especially our colleagues and nurses and our parents, of the importance of hip-safe swaddling. So I would make the simple plea to you to please teach this to your colleagues, to your nurses in your hospitals, to mothers around you in your well-baby clinics, because this one single simple maneuver can reduce the incidence of DDH by almost threefold without us doing anything else to screen the baby clinically or by ultrasound. So thank you very much for your attention.
So again, that's an excellent session by Dr. Hari Garuj. And thank you all the three speakers for the wonderful talk. And now we'll go to the discussion part. So I had two doubts regarding, one is how much sensitive is USG, ultrasonography hip detection, and from which age will start the X-ray of the hip for detection of DDH? So USG detection, how much is it? Let me see, in an expert hand, you can detect 100%?
So,
Ramni.
Okay.
Yeah, Ramni, please.
All right. Yeah, Dr. Kesavan. Yes, that's an important question you asked me. See, we are still trying to. When we are right now, Alaric is doing a great job in spearheading the whole process of screening, national screening program, and here we are actually trying to understand how well we can actually utilize ultrasound as well as an X-ray in order to screen the children for DDH. Now, answering your question, the ultrasound is a great tool, but unfortunately, we still need a consistency in its reporting because there are so many variables in an ultrasound. The quality of ultrasound, the actual ultrasound which is being done, the interpretation of ultrasound, the observer dependency, the various change, the observer, we have so much dependent on the person who's doing the ultrasound. And so these things are there. And X-ray, on the other hand, has been there for a longer period of time. And we still are seeing whether this relatively newer modality of ultrasound, is that actually better than an X-ray, which has always been considered as a gold standard. So ultrasound can be used very early. That is a plus point. It can be used during the time when the bones have not formed. It's very cartilaginous. Ultrasound is a dynamic study. You can actually move the hips and understand the instability that is there inside the hip. But again, like we discussed, there are so many small instabilities which can be there in the early part of infancy, which majority of them are actually not going to go ahead as and present as a true DDH. So there is, again, it's a double-edged sword, that an ultrasound. Whereas an X-ray, and the earliest you want to do an X-ray is 3.5 months. And definitely by 4 months, you would want to do an X-ray. That is purely because younger infant would be a little susceptible to the radiations by the X-ray. And the ultrasound and the X-ray, once it is done, it is freely available, and interpretation of an X-ray possibly is more consistent throughout the country. That is what we think. So I don't know whether I have answered your question, Dr. Keshavan. Is that what you were asking?
My second question is that whether such Arabic languages are already discussing chatbots, but whether is it needed a universal screening method for ADH, and how can we utilize the help of nursing staff and other paramedical staff for this purpose? Should be coming in a big way, then only I think we can detect more cases. So what about universal screening? And also, one place you mentioned about 0.1% is in Mumbai, and 70% some other area in India. Why there is a much variation in the incidence of the CDH? Different study, the problem with the study or something different? I think Ramani sir is that person that...
Now this is what is the dilemma that everybody is facing. On one hand, in some parts of, even in our own country, the incidence seems to be much less, and in some parts the incidence seems to be more. There seems to be some kind of ethnic factors in coming into play. The traditional practices like swaddling, which are being used in certain parts, which also probably is coming into play. And there are so many factors now we are trying to understand how they can influence the progression of DDH. Because now, as I started my talk, I actually emphasized on the fact that previously it used to be called as congenital dislocation. Now it is called a developmental dislocation, because depending upon what practices you are following, depending upon how aware you are about DDH, depending upon what better centers and what the more experienced orthopedic surgeons are there, who can, and the pediatricians, the role of pediatricians who can pick up DDH, it all depends upon so many variables which actually determine the incidence of DDH in that particular region or a country or a state. So what you are asking is absolutely relevant, and we are still trying to understand.
Variability, sir. 1%, 0.172, 17%. That much of a very big difference.
Exactly, but we can. What we are it's important to understand, Dr. Keshavan and everybody here, that what is important is not to miss out on clear-cut dislocations. I mean, as far as you are concerned, the instability, all these things are, on one side, but the frank dislocations, which are very obvious, they should not be missed, and they should be treated as early as possible. That is the message I think all three of us are trying to convey.
So now we have our PK Parvati madam, because we are seeing thousands and thousands of children, and also maybe interested in traditional method of swaddling and everything. So, madam, what is your experience? Can you say something about the BK Parvati, madam? Unmute, man. Unmute. Unmute, man. Unmute. Unmute. Unmute, man.
Dr. Parvati, you need to unmute.
Not what, man. Unmute, man. Unmute.
Yes, host has to unmute. That's it. It was a very nice presentation, all three of you. And I was not at all aware that the technique of swaddling is so important. And there may be so many people like me in the among the pediatricians and the staff nurses. I have seen so many of them doing like this, the wrong way only. So it's a new information for me.
Sir, that video is available, the correct method of swaddling, this video is there, sir.
I'll be putting some comments in the chat box for those who are on this call, that all of this information is freely available on the website. There is an organization called the International Hip Dysplasia Institute, where the URL is www.hipdysplasia.org, HIPDYSPLASIA, hipdysplasia.org. And all of these training videos are freely available. So you can download them, you can share them with your colleagues and your staff nurses. I think this is one factor which will have such a major impact on the incidence of DDH. And the good thing is that it will act right away. So we don't have to wait for 10 or 20 years for that incidence to change. By just instituting hip-safe swaddling, we can reduce the incidence of dislocation by almost 2/3, as been shown in several studies around the world. And it's a shame that we in India have gotten to this so late. But when I showed this to so many of my pediatric colleagues and my gynecology colleagues, they said, oh my God, we have been doing this for our own children, in fact. So we are so lucky that we managed to get away with it. Because that's the way that we have all been taught traditionally, and that's part of our culture. But I think a little change in that will bring down the incidence of DDH.
Madam, sir, please. Unmute, sir. Unmute, sir. Srijit, unmute all of them. Srijit, please unmute all of them. Srijit, sir, unmute. Srijit.
Sir, I have some connectivity issues. Sir, for your co-host, or you can unmute also.
Dr. Menon, you need to unmute.
Unmute,
Dr. Menon, you need to unmute.
Yes, it is possible.
Sorry. I think it was very educative. The trio of DDH have done a wonderful job. And I say this with all humility. I think we have made our, first of all, before we start training the nurses, training the Anganwadi worker, training the ASHA workers, we have to train our neonatologists and pediatricians in the correct methods of examining and as well as swaddling. Both are needed because these are the doctors, youngsters, the trainers for tomorrow who should be teaching. Dr. Alaric, I have seen the videos which you have shown on the website, but to my surprise, my own students do not watch them unless it is a part of the curriculum. Like we have made examining for retinopathy or prematurity as mandatory in all premature babies, it should be mandatory that all neonatologists or pediatricians attending to newborns are trained to evaluate for DDH at the earliest. Wherever they have been trained earlier, the incidence has been reported to be high. The lesser number of incidents does not really mean that the incidence is less. It means that the pediatricians are not trained well to detect them. If you look at the incidence data which has come from 1990 onwards, it is higher than the incidence of congenital hypothyroidism. Of course, the disease corrects over a period of time. Many of them are transient, like the way we say transient congenital hypothyroidism. It is transient. Sometimes they are corrected spontaneously. So the true incidence as the child grows may be coming lesser. But I think before we start training the field workers, the mothers, I think the pediatricians themselves have to become expert in, first of all, examining for DDH. For example, I would like to make it mandatory that all neonatologists, all pediatricians should have mandatory training in the nursery, in the neonatal nursery, of examining the babies under the supervision of a trained pediatric orthopedician. That would go well. I have a question here, if I may ask. Like we said that females, girls, as well as breech presentation is much more common. It is also my observation in my own department. But sometimes I feel that breech is probably, it is not very clear whether it is the cause or whether it is the effect. The baby may be presenting as a breech because baby is born with the DDH, maybe in advanced case. So that makes the baby to present like breech. It happens in several other conditions which breech is considered to be one of the reasons for developing, for example, transection of the cord and then developing hypopituitarism. So several other things are there. Also, the procedure of extracting the baby, assisted breech, maybe, is it responsible for the development of DDH, which happens in the immediate period, which may be detected in the second 2 weeks, but may disappear as the child is probably become spontaneous movements with normal activity. Maybe the experts can highlight on this issue.
Thank you, sir, for the beautiful comments. Now we have our Srinivasan, sir, past head of the department of DIPMA. Our regular VR, Dr. Srinivasan, sir. Over to Srinivasan, sir.
Yeah, very important area, very well covered, and all aspects have been told. And of course, very excellent in the beginning by straddling. So, 3 types of straddling have been told. So, thank you so much. So, still, of course, I find that even on neonatology side was missed. And then they had to do data surgical procedure. So, very important area has been identified and then attended to, and a very good topic, very well covered. I thank all the panelists for the justice to the public and to the management. And Dr. Parvati has mentioned that people should be made aware of these techniques so that help will be given the early stages.
Thank you, sir, for joining. And now you
need to
thank the Department of Pediatrics from Trishnu.
Thank you all the speakers. It's a wonderful session. My doubt here, we have been giving stress to the newborn screening, visible birth defect in Kerala, and we are more and more interested in the quality rather than the quantity. We have brought down the number less than a single digit in Kerala, but we are now concentrating on the quality of the babies. This is the most important thing to be included in the national program, but the how to do it, the practical aspect, but there's a 27 million babies are born, and here we are having 33,000 pediatricians, 15,000 orthopedicians, and maybe pediatric ortho still less. So how to do it? As the manager said, there is a need for training different categories, not only pediatricians. Pediatricians are very small number with this huge number. So each and every person, no need for to be a pediatrician. We need to train them how to pick up this. The Ottolani-Barlow's test should be taught to each and every pediatrician, and including the other, this also should be included. And maybe it should be done repeatedly in the first and second 6 weeks immunization well baby clinic, maybe 10 week all the three immunization sessions, this should be taught. And the other, all the category of the staff should be taught, as Menon sir said, it should be taught to the nursing staff, nursing student curriculum, it should be included, and the undergraduate teaching also to be included. It's such an important program, and it cannot be done with the pediatricians only, and it should be a good relation and a tie-up with the orthopedicians also to be involved. This one example, because it's a non-visible, unless you look for it, you will miss it. So hereafter, there's a need to cooperate between the orthopedicians also, and let it be a national program. We'll start from here. Maybe it was already there, but most of us were not aware of the swaddling technique and all. So very thank you sir for the wonderful sections, all the three speakers. Thank you
sir. Dr. Kishore Malpuri is there. Dr. Kishore Malpuri.
So he joined us for a short while, and then he had to leave to do some surgery. So he's just sent his regards and his wishes to the entire webinar committee. And he really thanks all of you all for taking this excellent initiative of including POSI and the screening committee in this symposium.
Now we have a neonatologist with us, Dr. Tony Mamberly. What's your experience as a neonatologist, Dr. Tony Mamberly?
Thank you very much, Dr. Ananda Jayasivan, for asking.
Can you open your video? Can you open your video?
I am speaking from my mobile. But anyway, this is a problem which has been neglected I have been practicing in Kerala for the last 23 years, and examination of the hip is not a routine by the JRs or residents. But I must tell you, the incidence of CDH when I was in England is about around 2.5 to 3 per thousand. And we have to examine the hip twice. And if you are able to pick up a dislocated hip or a dislocatable hip, your career is made in England. You have to examine the child routinely hips. Even they come at 6 months for a different problem, you examine the hip and you find there is a dislocatable hip. So there it is very important. Ultrasound was not there at that time, but now ultrasound is all. So I think it is not a part of the routine exam. It is only by doing examining normal hips, the abnormal will you will definitely feel. It is so rare. So when in the unit there is a positive Barlow or Ortolani, we should get the residents to feel it. Once they feel that clunk, I think they will pick it up. So they have to examine like femorals, routine, newborns, every baby. So the abnormal will definitely feel. But here, examination of the hip is not given that due importance. So I agree with all the speakers. They have done a wonderful job. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Tony, sir. Any other comments? I think we'll have Dr. Febby is there, Dr. Jelly is there, Dr. Dosani, Dr. Edison. Any comments by all these people, experts? Edison, sir, or Dr. Febby? Or Dr. Jelly, Dosani, sir?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. It was respected eminent faculty. It was a wonderful session. And one thing I want to tell is that in our unit, we in our postnatal examination and first day neonatal examination, we have made a checklist. So that is a hip examination. There is our checklist. So it should not be missed. Before the discharge, baby should have at least one should have done the Barlow test. So that made a rule for all the babies. So usually, as Tony sir told already, once you examine the normal Barlow, then only you will get the abnormal ones. Routinely, when we are examining the postnatal wards, the JRs may miss. So once we have to show, if the senior faculty is again examining the hip and finding the clunk, and showing the clung, a palpable clung, that feel or may not be getting in first. So you have to show that clung to your juniors, then they can teach their juniors. So that is, and even nurses. So Barlow test, once that is should be showing that positive signs will help to detect more positive babies. Otherwise, hip examination just for namesake they will do. So that is an important thing. We have to demonstrate the findings to the, our residents and our nurses. And second thing is that when we are having this visual birth defects, there is a checklist for the visual birth defect for DDH in nurses also, but they are not doing it because they don't know how to do Barlow's. So if we are training our RBSK, because one RBSK nurse is there for all neonatal screening for in Kerala or in all over the India. This RBSK nurses are trained for newborn screening. So if you have, if you are giving an exact video of Barlow or training the nurses for Barlow test, they will also will doing, they'll start practicing, they, then they start picking this. So this should be incorporated in the day. It is there in the RBSK, but we have to emphasize that this test should be done for mandatory for all babies. Thank you, sir.
So, Dr. Fabi is our neonatologist, and thank you for your excellent suggestion regarding the awareness program for JRs and Anganwadi workers. Fabi, can you give any idea how many cases DDH here you have seen, any statistics like that?
Sir, in our unit in the last 6 months, we had 3 cases, out of which one is detected by our screening, normal baby, without any breech presentation. Baby had an examination, we screened that baby. Other one was a dislocated hip with other congenital malformation. And one interesting case was during my DM period, we had one case with the DDH. When we are examining the DDH, we found that that baby had intact hymen. Okay, then collection was there in the vagina. So different combinations we have seen. But this screening one will detect only by clinical examination only. So that is very important. And I usually emphasize my PGs to train regarding hip as a routine, as Tony Mambul sir said. Definitely we have to do every baby. Then only we will see them. Then only we will pick the abnormal ones.
Dr. Kesavan, I'll just want to interject here. There are a couple of things which I missed, I think. There are two deformities which you as pediatricians need to be aware of in a newborn. If there is a torticollis, that is, if there is a wry neck, if the child is, you know, keeping the head on one side and there is some tightness which you see, that is one of the deformities which has a strong association with a DDH, which might be also there. And there is a deformity in the foot which is called metatarsus adductus. It is a midfoot deformity. And if that, any deformity for that matter, if you see in the foot, it's always prudent to examine the hips for DDH. So these two things need to be kept in mind when the child is born.
Dr. Anand, may I comment? Make a comment? Because it's... Make a comment, Anand? Because it's how to make it as a national program, we need to reach to the lowest level of the health workers, and it should be just like a slogan, simplest of the things which can be imparted to the lowest of the health workers, then only you can reach up to these 27 million babies born. So what should be the most simplest of the thing which can be taught? The pediatrician should be trainers training, and just like Dr. Fabi mentioned, we'll be training the RBSK nurses, we'll be training the lactation management counselors, and just like that, even the lowest category should be taught to pick up the simplest of thing. One thing just from the speakers I got was a flexion of the hip and the abduction. If the abduction is possible in the flexed position, very well. That is less likely to be CDH. Is that the simplest of the thing which can be taught to the these lowest measures, lowest of the health workers? And one more thing about the pediatricians, how to do the otolani and Barlow's maneuver and avoid X-ray in the first 3 months, and selective use of the USC. In the developed countries, maybe USC is possible, but the resource poor setting, which is a poor country, we can't afford, even though that is the best. the quality USG to be reserved for the after the screening process. So there should be a national program. It's a most important thing. How to implement that is to be thought out at the association level, at the national level.
I made a comment from Dr. Arik. Really, he's hard working for team work with EAP and NNF and other team. And Arik, can you give a last comment about this one?
So thank you, Dr. Purushottam. I think what your points were extremely pertinent. And I agree with all the senior pediatricians on this call. All of you all have raised points which are so important and which are very, very valid. And I can assure you that through this expert committee that we have developed, since we have on board not only orthopedic surgeons, but we have all of you from IIP, we have people from FOCSI and from the NNFI and the radiology associations as well, we will be attempting to develop guidelines which are effective for the whole population of India, not just for urban population. We must understand that a large part of our population, 70%, is rural. So as you rightly said, how do we reach the lowest of the health workers at the RBSK level, the Anganwadi workers and the ASHA workers who are in charge of maternal and child health care, the government program, and how to develop tests which are valid, reliable, and can be used by most of us in India, not something which can be used by a small population like ultrasound. So we are considering all of these points. We have taken all of that into consideration while we develop these guidelines. We have recently had the Delphi process, as I mentioned in my keynote address, of developing a consensus among all the different participants from various organizations. And I can assure you that with the help of all our different partner associations, we will develop guidelines as per your suggestion. I'll also request our president of FOCSI, Dr. Dhiren, who has been really spearheading this entire process, to give us a few words from his side as well. Dhiren?
Yeah. Thank you, Enric. I really enjoyed the session. And the first of all, I really like to appreciate the enthusiasm of pediatricians of Thrissur. I was not expecting such a good number, but I'm really happy that 57 pediatricians really attended this session. And when three other parallel webinars are going on, this is really a good number. And if all the pediatricians of India, if they show this much interest, then I'm sure that the apprehension which Dr. Purushottam mentioned about like how we will reach 27 million children, definitely we will be able to reach them also. So with that hope and optimism, I once again say thank you to IAP branch of Thrissur. And I also request Dr. Keshwan to encourage the IAP members, other IAP members, to have such webinars so that we can spread this awareness to as many colleagues as possible. Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments? I think we exceed time. So thank you, all the three speakers, Dhiren Ganjavasa, Ranadi Gadoj, and Dr. Ramani Narasimham. Now I invite Dr. Radhi Sandhama for her final words and for concluding the session. Over to Radhi Sandhama to conclude the session.
Thank you to all the three speakers for the excellent presentation. One take-home message which I was never aware of is about the safe swaddling. We didn't know about it. I do wish we had seen some videos on how to do the orthotolani and Barlow method. In addition, today, just something personal. I had always seen the book by Dr. P.S.N. Menon, but to see him today is a big honor on our Thrissur IAP site. That's all. Thank you. Thank you to all the senior leaders, Dr. Purushottam, Dr. Parvati, Dr. Jaleel, Dr. Tony Mampli,
Srinivasan sir,
everybody for contributing in the discussion too. Anandakeshwan sir, over to you.
So thank you very much. And thank you for spending this much of time with us and sharing our knowledge. So thank you very much, sir. Good night. Menon sir,
thank you.
Menon sir, and the Kanamati alone.